Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. For the last 2 or 3 weeks, I've spent a lot of time thinking about Philip Roth. Until this month, I rarely thought about Philip Roth, in fact, as rarely as possible. I've only read 2 of his books, I think, and I read both of them 30 years ago or so, Goodbye Columbus and Portnoy's Complaint. I disliked them both, and I believe they were more or less the last books I read written by a group of authors I sometimes call the mid-century misogynist. Perhaps in a future video, I'll talk more about that larger list, and perhaps some of you will convince me that not all of those authors are in fact misogynist, and that not all of their novels are poor choices for my reading list. But I'll leave that to another day. For reasons I cannot fully explain, I decided a few weeks ago to read both Blake Bailey's new biography of Philip Roth, published by a well-respected commercial press, and Ira Nadel's new biography of Roth, published by a well-respected university press. Why, you ask? Well, first, I really love to read literary biographies. It's one of my very favorite subgenres. And I'm a total sucker for books in pairs, whether 2 or more related books are published at the same time, or even if 2 related books just wind up next to each other on my shelves. But still, there are a ton of still unread literary biographies on my shelves, and to be honest, I can justify reading any 2 books together and then talk about how they speak to each other. So why Roth? Why did I arrange for these biographies to appear on my doorstep from their respective publishers? There are a couple of reasons. First, several readers I admire very much here on BookTube have had some positive things to say about some of Roth's novels. Courtney Farriter, I think, was the first person who really made me consider that I should give Roth another chance. I do know that my thinking about a lot of books has changed a great deal since I read Roth when I was a very young woman. To be honest, I still haven't actually read any Roth himself this month, and given what has happened this week, which I'll get into in a minute, I suspect I will wait a bit longer. But after the rawness wears off, I will be trying at least one more, one of the ones my BookTuber friends have recommended. The other major reason I picked up the 2 Roth biographies is because a few months ago I read and reviewed what I thought might be a similar kind of work, Richard Greene's subtle and thoughtful study of Graham Greene. I had never actually thought of Graham Greene as one of the mid-century misogynists, but I think a lot of readers might more or less place him in that group. Although I found his short novel, The End of the Affair, quite introspective and beautiful, a lot of his books have relatively thinly drawn women characters and emphasize a kind of macho adventure that I personally find boring, even when designed to be exciting. In addition to that, of course, is the fact that Greene was widely known to be quite a womanizer. Nevertheless, Richard Greene's biography was one I found surprisingly moving. He doesn't deny or hide the fact that Greene was a womanizer or a sexist, but he makes a choice to discuss that fact only in relatively abstract ways, except in the cases where particular women mattered in much larger ways in Greene's life. Richard Greene can be honest about the novelist womanizing without always salaciously telling all the gory details, the ins and outs of all the encounters, so to speak. What matters here, the biographer seems to say, is that Greene was a womanizer, and perhaps why, not the actual details about all the encounters. Instead, Richard Greene focuses more on what constituted Graham Greene's construction of himself as a writer and thinker. By the end of the biography, I had great empathy and understanding for the novelist, still, nevertheless, with full awareness of his many flaws. I guess when I picked up the Roth biographies, I was hoping for some of the same kind of understanding, or maybe even consideration, that I now have for Greene, even though I don't especially want to go reread Greene's novels. Suffice it to say that neither of the 2 Roth biographies left me with any feelings like that, even before the news broke that several women had made accusations against biographer Blake Bailey of sexual misconduct. Let me talk very briefly for just a moment about both of the books themselves, and then I'll get to the fallout that has happened since the accusations were made public. I received and started reading Ira Nadel's A Counterlife first, which begins with an attempt to understand what motivated Philip Roth to live as he lived and write as he wrote. Basically, Nadel points to the fact that rage and revenge were at the heart of it all. Anger was for Roth essential, and something he believed was justified, something that was caused by someone else. Even Roth acknowledged that rage is where everything began, not only in his own life, but in literature. After all, the first line in Homer's Iliad tells us that the bard will sing of the rage of Achilles. It isn't exactly clear to me why Roth particularly embraced rage. Mostly, it seems to be just a cultural expectation or trope for men writing in mid-century America. Or maybe from Roth's mother telling him when he was 11 years old that he was too small to need a jockstrap in his bathing suit, which apparently he took personally. Roth doesn't seem to have enough self-awareness or interiority to be able to fight against it, to rage against rage. To be honest, Nadel's book is horribly organized and astonishingly repetitive. His thesis is in conflict with Bailey's arguments, but his actual framing of Roth's life is not all that different. Actually, the one thing that I think Nadel does substantially better than Bailey, aside from the issues I'll talk about in a second, is that he actually discusses Roth as a writer, at least to a degree, rather than just an obnoxious man. Well, on to Bailey. When this arrived in the mail and I looked at the full title of Bailey's biography, I rolled my eyes. Philip Roth, the biography. What kind of author has that kind of chutzpah? Well, perhaps one that would bite off the project of writing an authorized biography of Philip Roth. I knew I wasn't being fair. Maybe Bailey wasn't as arrogant as this title implied. Maybe it was someone at the publishers who had insisted. Well, after reading some of the book and watching Bailey in early promotion interviews online, I realized very quickly that whether the press chose that subtitle or the author did, Bailey is, in fact, an arrogant narcissist. I kept wondering why Bailey effectively defends Roth against all sorts of charges, especially those made by some of the women in his life, merely by repeating the self-defenses that Roth had given Bailey. I say I wondered why an author would do that. In fact, I joked with a friend about the fact that it was just a matter of time before stories broke about Bailey's own private performances of misogyny. I had absolutely no idea how quickly accusations would come out or how intense some of those stories would be. Let me give you a few examples of the ineffective efforts to justify Roth's poor behavior, which Bailey puts forward. Portrayals of women I find dated, at the very least, to use the most positive wording I can imagine saying. Women are fairly often portrayed as nags or irritants. They, quote, harangue the men in their lives, to use Bailey's language, not Roth's. They're sometimes histrionic or even, quote, deeply unstable, and frequently they're portrayed by both Roth and Bailey as nothing but caretakers or sex objects. Roth had serious women friends, especially later in his life, but the stories that really get the attention in this biographer's work are at the very least unempathetic. With absolutely no critique or explanation of Roth's attitudes, Bailey says that Roth was, quote, frightened by the withered and discolored intimate parts of his first wife, and that she was, quote, an unlikely consort for such a handsome, promising young man. Bailey and I have different tastes in men, it seems. Not only does Bailey not point out that Roth's statement saying he was frightened by his wife's sexuality is a misogynist trope, he also seems to argue that it justified the fact that Roth cheated on her and abandoned her and publicly condemned her as a hysterical schizophrenic, not meant as a diagnosis, but just as a slur. It goes on and on, but I am not going to go on and on. In the days after publication, both positive and negative reviews were appearing all over the place, and Bailey was acting like an entitled brat on Zoom interviews. One especially creepy one, which I watched, was with Mary Carr. She had been friends with Roth late in his life, apparently talked extensively with Bailey about his draft, and provided a blurb for the back of the biography's first edition. Although they clearly talked quite a bit before over a course of years, Bailey tries to put Mary Carr on edge at the very beginning of the interview by saying that Roth did not want him to talk to her. Later in the interview, when Bailey tries to explain his claim, it never really sounds like a coherent story. But his action did immediately serve to displace the typical power dynamics of an interviewer and an interviewee. Carr gets her bearings back very quickly, of course, saying that Roth had told her on his deathbed that she was going to have to defend him when he died. Her response? "Philip, you're indefensible," which she said made Roth roar with laughter. Bailey really doesn't seem to think it's a funny line. Later, Carr very pointedly says she personally abhors guys who use their class rosters as dating lists, and suggests that that kind of behavior is just not tolerated anymore. Bailey doesn't really respond to that statement, which certainly became relevant the very next day. Instead, he insists that Roth didn't sleep with all of his young female students. He actually slept, whatever that means, involving intimacy or snoring, I don't know, with only two of them, although he dated many and tried to date more. As if that makes everything okay. And maybe even that it makes Roth a victim of unreasonable critique. Throughout the interview, Bailey often sidesteps Carr's serious questions, but instead insists on repeatedly defending Roth and defending himself from other critics. He seems irritated when she asks some supportive but nevertheless challenging questions. In response, he tells her she liked his book and then talks about the blurb she had provided for the back of the book. That's just weird, and maybe shows a total lack of self-assuredness. How valuable he is, or how valuable he thinks he is the story that matters to him, even if he facetiously says pshaw when given an enormous compliment. Another story about Bailey's pettiness came out from another biographer, not of Roth, but of Shirley Jackson. That book, by Ruth Franklin, was reviewed by Bailey, who went on a tirade about how Franklin's criticism of Jackson's husband's behavior was only because Franklin was too feminist. The biographer had pointed out that the sexist statement Jackson's unfaithful husband had made about her were unkind. Not surprisingly, Ruth Franklin was annoyed not by Bailey's critiques, in what was overall a fairly positive review, but by what she saw as his male supremacy. And here's the key bit for me. When Franklin was offered the opportunity to review Bailey Roth's biography, she declined. She declined because she knew that her annoyance at what she saw as his sexism might shape any review she would write, and she thought that was unethical. Rather than lashing out in revenge, perhaps explicitly turning around what he had said and accusing him of being too misogynist or whatever, she stood back and kept her mouth shut until the news of the various allegations broke. Just as a side note, this story raises a lot of issues about the ethics of assigning book reviews, which I think I want to talk about a bit more sometime in the future. Anyway, very soon after the Mary Carr and Blake Bailey discussion, news outlets started talking about accusations by former students who claimed that Blake Bailey was a sexual predator. Most of the accusations were made by women Bailey had taught when they were 12 or 13 years old, but not had sex with until they were above Louisiana's legal age of consent. Many of them claimed he had treated the girls in his 8th grade classroom in ways that had sexualized them. He assigned Lolita to these young girls, a book that I will be talking about very soon that is definitely worthy of literary study, but seems to me absolutely inappropriate for a male teacher to assign to girls at the cusp of puberty. One girl talked about how Bailey had physically picked her up on her birthday, spun her around, pinched her bottom, and told her that she was really stacked for a short girl. Many of these women felt he had been essentially grooming them from the time they were junior high students until they reached legal age. And all of them accused him of initiating sexual contact in situations which varied from pressured or not exactly consensual to outright rape with verbal and physical resistance. And then another rape accusation emerged. In 2015, at the home of a major New York Times book critic, Valentina Rice, a publishing executive, was staying overnight at the same time that Blake Bailey was at the house. In 2018, Rice wrote somewhat anonymously to W.W. Norton, Bailey's publishing house, to say that in the middle of the night, Bailey had come into her room and raped her while she tried to push him off and kept repeating, "Stop." Rice wanted the publishers to know about Bailey's actions so they would not put female publishers or others in positions of risk. W.W. Norton apparently did not respond to her letter, but the publishers did forward the email to Bailey. While Bailey insists that he has never had what he calls illegal sex, he has acknowledged much of the basic framework. In 2020, he told one of the former students that he did not like to be reminded of his, quote, awfulness on that night with a young woman many years earlier. He tried to explain his behavior by saying he was suffering from mental illness at the time. Importantly, these statements are not allegations, but are in fact from emails sent from his own email address, which he has not suggested were forged in any way. He told one accuser that his behavior was deplorable, but not illegal, and he asked the publishing executive to keep her allegations private because it was the decent thing to do. As he said, "I have a wife and daughter who adore me." That last line really rankles me. Why does he think the decent thing to do is for an accuser not to go public in order to keep a partner who adores you from knowing your misbehavior, whether he believed it was rape or merely serial adultery? And then there is the narcissism involved there. He doesn't say he has a wife and daughter he loves and to whom he is committed despite his actions. Instead, they adore him. Wildly, before I read the news reports, I had underlined an obnoxious passage in Bailey's acknowledgments section. Instead of sharing his love for his family, he does the same thing here. He states that they let him travel all over the world for research because they love me. He does not say he loves them, although he does offer them love and gratitude, to be fair. Still, he seems far more interested in the fact that other people adore him than he is in expressing what he feels about others. Bailey's absolute obsession with correcting or overriding negative reviews seems like it's of a piece with his fixation on how other people see him rather than looking at his own behavior. Like Roth, Bailey seems to think that his irritation or anger are all someone else's fault. When the news about the accusations broke, which maybe was the morning after the Mary Carr interview, she began to see how poorly he treated other people, especially women, and including herself. She wrote on Twitter that the accusations were totally credible, and that she would be asking W.W. Norton to remove her blurb from the back of the book in all future printings. And now, it seems her request is unnecessary. When the stories were first starting to break, W.W. Norton put distribution and publicity temporarily on hold for the book. And now the press has announced that they are permanently taking the book out of print and making a donation to organizations that work against sexual assault in an amount equal to the mid-six-figure advance they had given Bailey. I'm sympathetic to those who argue that pulling books from publication because of accusations is premature and maybe even censorship. And I am also sympathetic to the idea of separating great art from a flawed artist. But in this case, I don't believe either issue is actually applicable. First, Norton completely released Bailey from his contract, and he is free to publish the book with other presses. While you might say that is unlikely to happen, I would argue that since even Woody Allen was able to get his book placed elsewhere and to make a lot of money from it, everything is still on the table. Several respected writers, including Mary Carr and even feminist Elaine Showalter, felt that Bailey's book might be in the running for a Pulitzer Prize. Another publisher might be thrilled to take it on. Assuming that the book contract does not forbid a publisher from pulling out of a deal, it just isn't censorship. The argument that making a final judgment just based on accusation is perhaps true in a way, but Norton's decision was based not on some moral judgment, but instead on finances and the press's reputation, how this brouhaha might affect Norton's ability to acquire future manuscripts and workers, etc. Again, if not prohibited by the contract, this is their right. Although I'm certainly not campaigning to have the book taken out of print for the good of readers or something, I'm also not opposed to Norton's actions here. Secondly, the whole issue of separating art from artist is really hard here. A more sensitive biographer might have been able to place some of Roth's sexist comments or behaviors in context, in a way that would not try to support them as much as explain them, helping us to understand both the personal and social context of other people, especially people from different eras or different cultures or different sexes even, is part of the magic of what biographies can do. But instead, Bailey responds with almost identical anger and defensiveness to not only accusations made against Roth, but to the same basic kinds of accusations against himself. I was not by any means the only person to see very early on that Bailey and Roth seemed to have something deeply in common. But even if he merely engaged in what Bailey himself called awfulness with former students, then tried to hide it from his wife, and then got defensive about it, makes not only the biographer hard to separate from his subject, but also the book hard to separate from its creator. What I think is most striking is how ineffective Bailey's book is as a defense of Philip Roth's statements and behaviors. Were a biographer to recognize the misogyny of so many of the men raised in his generation and put Roth's life in that context and explain as much as he could about why Roth felt so much pain and anger, and then perhaps go on to treat all of the other characters in the book with that same kind of compassion and desire to understand, the biography might have left readers with the sense that Roth had in fact become a figure we could see with new eyes. That is exactly what I was talking about when I mentioned the biography of Graham Greene at the beginning of this video. But for Bailey to use misogynist rhetoric to excuse Roth's misogynistic behavior does not make Roth any more interesting or make his books any more appealing to read, and it doesn't make Bailey seem interesting or his books appealing to read either. Thanks for joining me today here on Hannah's Books. See you soon.